Good morning, New Hope. It is August the 14th, and I am glad you are here today. Thank you for coming out and being part of our fellowship and our worship this morning. This is just our second week of trying our announcements before the service starts, and thank you for giving me your attention. Please give us some feedback. Ryan and I would love to hear your suggestions about what we're doing because we are really playing this by ear. But we're so glad you're here today, and we want to bring you up to speed of some things that are going to be happening around the New Hope Church family over the next few weeks. Since it's back to school, it's also kind of back to church for a lot of us who've had opportunities to go away, to enjoy some vacation, a little downtime. But now we're going to get back in the full swing of things, and that is true for here at church as well. So let me highlight several things that are going to be taking place. Grief Share is going to be getting started right along with back to school. Sue Krause, our leader, is going to do two different sessions. She's going to do a daytime and a nighttime. August the 16th, we'll begin the daytime study, and that's from 9:30 to 11:30. And then on August the 17th, she will start the evening, which will run from 6:30 till 8:30. If you have any questions, Sue's phone number is in the bulletin. Please give her a call. She would love to answer any of those questions or sign up as the sign-up sheet comes by a little bit later in the service. We have two women's Bible studies starting up in September. On Tuesday night, beginning September the 13th, we have a women's Bible study called Loving Justice, How God Works Against Injustices in the World. Nan Isom will be leading that, and this sign-up sheet will be coming around, and you can sign up for that Tuesday night Bible study. Then there is a Wednesday morning Bible study starting Wednesday, September the 14th. It will go from 9 to 11, and they're going to be doing a study called A Walk Through the Gospels, and Diana Rood will be teaching that class. That's also on the sign-up sheet. So whichever classes or Bible studies you want to be a part of, sign up to make sure that they have enough materials when you arrive. Not to be outdone, the men are also going to be starting their Tuesday evening Bible study. It's going to be led by our associate pastor, Pastor Mark Addis. He's going to be looking at a book written by Max Licato called The Power of Simple Prayer. Men, that sign-up sheet is also coming around on the clipboards this morning. Our Jam Kids are going to be getting back into full stride as school starts as well. And so on Wednesday nights, you can bring your elementary age children, really from kindergarten all the way through the sixth grade. And they are going to be studying Cooking with Jesus, Recipes for Success. So mom and dad, hope you bring your kids out on Wednesday night starting September the 7th. Also on Wednesday night, for you parents who are bringing your kids, you might want to be a part of this class. Pastor Mark Addis is going to be teaching Revolutionary Parenting, How to Raise Spiritual Champions. And if you have any more questions about that, please give Pastor Mark a call. If you are here today and it is your first or second visit, I would love for you to take one of the communication cards that's in the pew in front of you, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by later in our service, and then through the mail, we're going to send you information that tells you about New Hope. We promise. We're not going to beat on your door or pester you on the telephone, but through the mail, we'll send you information we hope will be very, very helpful. It's coming Tuesday evening at a place called the Macaroni Grill. There's a special event taking place. You've heard about this organization the last 2 weeks as I've talked about it. It's called How, Helping One Woman. I got introduced to it because our daughter Ashley had been asked numerous times to go to this very special event, and finally she gave in, and she went. And when Ashley went to this dinner, she found out that this was an organization that likes to help and encourage somebody who's going through a tough time. And they were asked to write a name on a card and to put it into a bowl or a and at the end of the evening, a name is pulled out, and that's going to be the next woman who they're going to help. And Ashley put down Jan Patton's name from our church. Jan, as you know, was a few months ago, was stabbed 7 times and spent several weeks in the hospital. We announced this to Jan on Tuesday night at our marriage Bible study so that she won't be completely shocked, and we were told she needed to know. And so we announced it on Tuesday night to her, and we have here with us Charlotte Bavaro, and she's going to tell us. Charlotte, you are one of the founders, is that correct, of How? So Charlotte, come on up and take a few minutes and tell us about this incredible organization that you are a part of.
Thank you, Pastor. Pastor
You bet.
Jim.
Just, is it on?
Microphone,
perfect.
Everything. Yeah, I told Ashley, she says, just press this button. I said, Ashley, I can barely see the microphone. Can you just turn it on for me? And she did. I'm also, Charlene, I'm not a public speaker, but I am a talker. So I'm going to keep my eye on Shelley, and she's going to kind of give me a, if I start talking too long. I'm very passionate about how, and I'll tell you why. Because it is an invitation. It's an invitation to women in our community to get together for an evening over a meal, connecting with old friends, making new friends, and supporting a woman in our community who's going through a time of what we call irreplaceable loss. And we found that is a very hard thing to define. Well, what is an irreplaceable loss? I can tell you what it isn't. It isn't the dog tore up your Prada shoes. I've never had any, but that still wouldn't be an irreplaceable loss. It isn't that your husband left you with the kids and he was a crummy guy. That isn't. Something that Charlene is going through is what we define as an irreplaceable loss. What started out, we were just going to get together, my girlfriend and I, because life gets busy, we don't have time. Let's just set a date, have dinner once a month, and connect. Well, why don't we invite the other women we've been trying to connect with and ask them to come too? Well, we've done some fundraising before. Well, why don't we, when we get together for dinner, everybody chip in. Is that a signal? No. When we get together for dinner, why don't we just make a donation to a different nonprofit organization every month? Then as women do, we keep talking and we start thinking. And my husband says that's when it gets scary. And we thought, well, what about the woman who's actually going through that? Wouldn't it be cool if we could just help her? The monetary gift that we give her is just a tangible expression of our support. The women that are going to attend the dinner in Jan's honor on Tuesday night, the majority of them have never met Jan. All they know is there's a woman in our community that needs our support. And that's what we do. When you walk in, you see a big glass bowl. It says, place your gift here. It's not a donation. It's a gift. And every penny of that goes to Jan that night. It's counted in front of everybody. And we gift that to her. While this is going on, we send out to the tables a recipient nomination form. And my Ashley friend there, I have been trying to get her to come. She told me about Jan. So we didn't have anybody else to nominate, so we put Jan's name in, and it was drawn. It's randomly selected, because how do you decide, well, so-and-so deserves it more than so-and-so? No. That's not our call. It's a random selection. They just have to meet the criteria of irreplaceable loss. And I can tell you that next week when I go to the dinner for Jan, I'm going to fill out a nomination form for Charlene, because Charlene could use some emotional support. And people don't realize the cost of being sick. You don't think about all of the doctor's trips. And a lot of times they're not local. They're in San Francisco or they're in the LA area. And it's an unconditional gift. She can use it however she wants. We're not a religious organization, but it has become my personal ministry. Every dinner that I go to, always, I leave encouraged, uplifted, and depending on how I've been during the week, ashamed. Sometimes I'm very ashamed, sometimes I'm a little ashamed that I have ever complained about anything in my life. God has blessed me with good health. He's blessed me with a community that is full of good people that want to give. And like I said, I'm a talker, so I've got to have to find a cutoff point. This will probably be it. For those of you that can attend, we welcome you and we're looking forward to it. For those of you who can't, we know that all of you are supporting Jan through your thoughts and your prayers. Thank you for inviting me. It's all about invitation. And I'm so happy that Ashley invited me to come to church today. And I felt right at home. Thank you. Okay.
Is it too late to buy a ticket for the dinner?
Okay, let me explain how that works.
Okay.
We don't sell tickets. It's very simple. It sounds complicated, and most of the time people don't even get our name right. Oh, we want to go to WOW. Well, WOW, we would love to have you, but we're how. It's kind of turning into who's on first. You know, yeah. People aren't sure. But you just come to the Macaroni Grill, and you go to the cash line or the credit card line. They've got it down. You just buy your dinner ticket.
Okay.
If you're not able to join us for dinner, you'll see the big glass bowl with Jan's gift that will go there.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so very much. Some of you have already given because we've talked about this for a couple of weeks and said if you're not able to go on Tuesday night that you could still be a part of what's given, and so you can put it in an envelope, you can make it to New Hope. We're going to take one check on Tuesday night. We're going to put it in that bowl. Okay. Okay. All right. Okay. Okay. All right. We'll do that. So just turn into the offering today, and we'll see that it's added to that. They would love to have you come for the dinner, all right? It would be great if it's a sellout, okay? So you are welcome. Open invitation. It starts at 6 o'clock, 6 o'clock, all right? So, yes?
I was curious, do they do it the same Tuesday every month?
Yes, it is the same Tuesday, third Tuesday every month, okay? Same place every month, same place every month, okay? All right, yes, Ashley?
And also, because I didn't know this when I first went, men can come too, even though it's a women's, organization.
They allow men? Wow. All right. Okay. So, men, you are invited too. So, husbands and wives, you certainly could go as well. All right? And thank you so much for coming and being with us today and sharing more about it. And we're excited about what you do. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward on us as we have our tithes and our offerings. In the next service, we have one other thing that you guys miss out on. And that is we have a baby dedication. We have four baby dedications in the next service. It's the entire Allard family. All right. So that will be very exciting. Would you join with me as we pray? Our Father, for the life that you share with us, we are so grateful. For the privilege of being able to share the life that you offer to us with others is an awesome privilege. And we get to share that life in so many different ways. And Lord, we've learned about another way in which we can do that today as kindness and generosity is reflected through this organization called HOW. It really does make us go, wow. It enables us to see your hands and your feet demonstrated in a different kind of way to those who are in need. And so we simply seek your best through their work. Father, for our privilege of worship today, I trust that we have come with a sense that, that Father, your incredible love for us has made a difference in our lives, and we cannot go a week without saying thanks. I trust we couldn't go without a day without saying thanks. And so we're here today, Father, maybe in need of something that we need to receive from you, but I trust we've also come here today understanding there is something we need to give to you, and that is our thanks. You've loved us. You've pursued us. You have our best interests at your heart, and we want to say thanks. We trust you with the needs that we've talked about and so many others. I'm grateful that you are a God who knows. And so that even in our forgetfulness, you know how to care. We trust you for all this in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I invite you to find Psalm 118, if you would, please. We'll be reading from there in just a moment. Psalm 118 will also be on the screen behind me. But before I read the passage, I want to throw a thought out at you. Belief should dictate attitude, which ought to drive our behavior. Our beliefs should dictate our attitude and should drive our behavior. The flip side to that truth is circumstances dictate our attitude and drive our behavior. One brings about consistency. The other one, I firmly believe, will end up in calamity. And I think David wants us to understand that, and I think that's the reason that he wrote Psalm 118. I think we'll discover why as we talk about it in a few minutes. We're in this series called The Less More Lifestyle. It got started the first of the year simply thinking about what do I want less of and what do I want more of in my life in the next year. Most of us are very familiar with I want less weight, more shape. I want less debt, more savings. And what I challenged this church family with in the month of January was to spend some time talking to the Lord those first few weeks of the new year and ask Him, what are the less more issues in your life? What is it that He wants to pinpoint? Not my job to try to pinpoint it for you. It's your job to ask Him to pinpoint it for you. Are you somebody who worries a lot? Then maybe what you would like, where the area of growth you would like in your life for this year was less worry, more trust. Less frustration, more peace. Less immaturity, more spiritual growth. And if you've only been coming for a few weeks, then I'll ask you the same question. We're in this series all year. I know we live in a culture, I've talked about this recently, we live in a culture which likes sound bites. The thing in pastoral ministry that's coming out of all places, don't have sermon series that last more than 6 weeks. Your people can't listen that long. I think y'all are smarter than that. I realize you're probably an exceptional congregation to all the other ones around the world, but I think you can handle more than 6 weeks. I think we try to get in a hurry sometimes to move to the next thing when God needs to spend some time working on fewer issues at greater length in our lives. And so it's not too late for you to think, Tim, Lord, tell me, what is it in my life that I need to get rid of some stuff, less of this, so there's more of this in my life? And what we are going to discover from David today in this psalm is there are some things that we need to have a lot less of, and there are some things we need to have a lot more of. And I hope you'll pick up on what David wants to tell us. Let's just read it in its entirety, and then we'll go back through and break it down a little bit verse by verse. David writes these things. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His love endures forever. Sounds like a song we've sung here before, doesn't it? Let Israel say, His love endures forever. Now just remember, David is keen when he writes this. So in this opening phrase, David says, as king, personally, I'm giving thanks to the Lord because His love endures forever. Israel, my nation, you need to say, His love endures forever. Oh, how I would shout if one of our presidential nominees would say, oh, America, God's love endures forever. Verse 3, let the house of Aaron say, His love endures forever. The house of Aaron, that's the spiritual leaders of the nation of Israel. And maybe the reason our presidential nominees are not saying it enough is because maybe the spiritual leaders in this nation aren't saying it often enough. Verse 4, let those who fear the Lord say, His love endures forever. In my anguish, I cried to the Lord, and He answered by setting me free. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? What's the worst we could do to each other? We could, take our life. The scripture says, don't worry about the one who can take your physical life. Worry about the one who determines your eternal destiny. So he says, hey, if they kill me, I get to go. Remember last week we talked about, for those who do not know Christ, death is the curse of our sin. For those of us who have received Christ, not religious folks, this is not receiving religion, this is receiving Christ, like a thief on a cross, moments before he died, had not one moment to become religious, only had time to engage with Jesus. And in this engagement with Jesus, something very, very special took place. He was no longer afraid to die. Because death to a believer is not the curse of our sin. That was satisfied by the death of Jesus Christ on the cross. But to a believer who has a relationship with Jesus Christ, death is the blessing of faith. It's the reward at the end. We don't have that perspective quite often enough because there's too much of the world in us and not enough of Christ. What we believe drives our attitude, which directs our activity. Let's read on. The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I look in triumph on my enemies. So notice, David is saying, hey, life is not a bowl of cherries. I got enemies. There are people who don't like me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than trust in princes. We'll come back to that in a minute. All the nations surround me, but in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side, but in the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They swarmed around me like bees, but they died out as quickly as burning thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. We'll come back to that because that's a pretty interesting terminology. I was pushed back and I was about to fall. But the Lord helped me. He held me up. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die but live, and I will proclaim what the Lord has done. I got to pause just for a minute. Shelly and I watched a movie last night. What was the name of it? Miracles from Heaven? Yeah, it's the Garner movie, okay? I had not seen it. I recommend it, okay? It's a great, great movie. Didn't realize at the leadership summit that some of us from New Hope attended this week, there were 300,000 people engaged in this leadership conference through satellite all around the United States and Canada. And it was just an incredible experience. And most of us are probably familiar with T.D. Jakes, all right, big black preacher from Texas. And I did not realize that T.D. Jakes had gotten into filmmaking. And he's the one who produced that film, all right, Miracles from Heaven. And it's a true story. You're probably not going to want to watch it because I'm going to tell you what happens in it. But it's worth seeing. I'll leave a few cliffhangers. But it's about a family, all right, a husband and wife and their three kids and their middle daughter, all right, probably about 8 years of age, ends up gravely ill. She has an intestinal issue where her intestines basically don't work. She can't process food. There is no cure for this. She ends up, her mom, very relentless, gets her to a specialist in Boston. They buy her a little time, all right, but he finally tells her, you need to just go home and love on your daughter and enjoy what time you have. And so they go home back to the country, and her older sister gets the middle sister to come out and kick a soccer ball around again, even though her belly's very bloated and she's in pain. She goes outside, and then she gets her a butterfly, takes them to an old dead oak tree in their pasture, and it's one they used to climb together before she got sick. And the older sister says, come on, let's climb it one more time. Let's do it together. And so she convinces her, and they climb up, and they get about three stories up this tree, and they sit out on a big giant limb, and as they're sitting on it, it cracks. And the older sister's frantic. She tells her younger sister, jump for that limb hanging out over there. I'll go this way, you go that way. And she's terrified, but she leaps, and when she leaps, she literally falls into the tree. It's hollowed out inside because it's rotten. And she falls inside the trunk of this tree three stories and hits the ground. Fire trucks come. Law enforcement come. It takes them hours to get her out. They take her to the hospital. They find out she's breathing. When the doctor comes out, he looks at the parents and says, I don't know how to tell you this. Your daughter had a three-story fall. She laid for hours alone in the bottom of a tree. She doesn't have one broken bone. She doesn't have a concussion. There is nothing wrong with your daughter. And the next day, she's out playing. And she's in no pain. She's cured. She's healed by a three-story fall. I'm not going to recommend that you should go find a building and jump off of it, okay? But here's the kicker. Here's why I'm telling you this story. It's because that little girl needed to tell her story. She had shared her faith with another little girl in the hospital of why she wasn't afraid to die. This mom had lost her faith. See, belief did not drive her attitude that would drive her behavior. It was when her daughter told her the story of what had happened to her in that time in the bottom of that tree that the mother's faith was restored, and now she wanted to tell the story. Says, I will not die, but live. That little girl didn't die. She lived. For what purpose? Claim a story. And David said, that's what I'm going to do. The Lord has chastened me severely, but he has not given me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks for you. You've become my salvation. These next three verses may be the most familiar. Even though you may not have known the address with Psalm 118, you're going to recognize these verses. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. And the Lord has done this, and it's marvelous in our eyes. Verse 24 is the one we all know. This, say it if you know it, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, save us, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. With bows in hand, join in the festal procession up to the horns of the altar. That's where the sacrifices are made. You are my God, and I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures. There was a visiting preacher who once stayed at the house of a widow. He had arrived 30 before he was to preach on Sunday, and the lady of the house, that sort of person, had given up her master bedroom to the guest. When he got up in the morning, he threw back the curtains of the window and he looked out at a most beautiful scene. Hills way in the distance with green pastures. But he was intrigued to notice that in the corner of the window pane, there was childlike writing on the glass. He could just barely make out the words. And the words were, this is the day. At breakfast, he asked his hostess, was this done by your grandchild who maybe had been playing while you were sleeping? No, she said. I etched that in the glass myself. I did it with the diamond from my wedding ring. And then she explained, having lost her husband a few years before, there were many times when she would throw open the curtains and she could not see a beautiful country scene, but all she saw were dark clouds and pouring rain. She said, I would then end up in despair and discouragement, and I would have no wish to go out and join the world. Having lost my partner, I felt like my meaning for life had gone. Then one morning, a moment of bleak despair, this woman said, I opened my Bible from my daily reading, and the passage I read that day was this. This is the day which the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And she said, the Holy Spirit reminded me that God had a plan for me still yet. And now, as every day began, no matter what the weather is, no matter what the circumstances are, I throw back the curtains. And as she explained to the preacher, she said, I want to look into the day through the promises of God. You get that? I want to look into the day through the promises of God. I don't want to look at the promises of God today. But I want to look at the day through the promises of God. This is the day, she said, and whether the Lord calls me or comes for me, I want to live this day for him. I think David, in this chapter gives us 8 observations of how we can live our life like that. Less grumbling, more gratitude. Let me highlight these 8 observations that David makes in these verses. Number 1, David directs us to respond with gratitude for the Lord's affection. Notice that in those first 4 verses. Give thanks, his love endures forever. Let Israel say, his love endures forever. Let Aaron, the house of Aaron, say, his love endures forever. Let those who fear him say, his love endures forever. David is saying, I never want to forget how much God has loved me, and I want to thank him for it. I don't know that William Shakespeare has ever been known as a great theologian, but listen to what he wrote. He said, O Lord, who lends me life, lend me a heart replete with thankfulness. How thankful are you for the love of Christ? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, nobody left out, believes in him, would not perish, but have what? Everlasting life. Not only the quantity of life of God that never ends, but the here and now, on this day. And David says, I never want to forget to thank him. May I suggest to you that it's not only this life of gratitude that we ought to have towards God, but I think when we have been the recipient of his love and we respond to him in gratitude, I believe in growing measure we will learn how to respond to each other with love and gratitude. It's what I sense that Howe was doing, responding to others with love and gratitude. What comes out of your mouth more often? Love and gratitude or complaints and frustration? See, belief will drive your attitude, which will drive your behavior. I've told a story of my dad at a testimony service at the church we grew up in. Leading testimony, those were the days when you'd have Sunday nights or Wednesday nights, and you'd ask people, hey, if you got a testimony, stand up and share it. And folks would stand and talk about what God had done in their life. But we had a particular lady in our church at the time who she would always stand during testimony service, and she would always gripe. It was not a very good testimony, but she always griped every time. When you're up front, sometimes we're thinking ahead, okay? We're thinking about what we're going to say next, and we sometimes lose track of what was just said. And that happened to be one of those moments with my dad. He really wasn't realizing who it was that was speaking and that she was grumbling. He was moving on to share with the congregation something he had read that week that stuck out to him. And the quote that he had read that week that stuck out to him is, sometimes the reason your dog tired at night is because you've growled all day. That I have no doubts. I knew this woman most of my life. I have no doubts that she loved the Lord, but somewhere in the connect of her spiritual life, she didn't remember how much God loved her, nor did she give great gratitude for it. She tended to be dictated by the circumstances of her day. And folks, you and I are the hands and the feet and the lips of Christ in this world. The scripture itself says the world will know that we are Christians, not by our grumbling, not by how we vote at the precincts during political moments. The world will know that we are Christians by our love. And how we talk and express ourselves to them makes a difference. Read an interesting statistic this week that it says the praise to criticism ratio, just to keep us at even keel. This isn't even to encourage us. This is just to keep us even. Is we need 4 praises to every 1 criticism. 4 praises to every 1 criticism. When I thought about that, I thought, wow. And then I realized that's the same principle that my boss told me at the Bible House almost 40 years ago when he said, Tim, for every customer that you make angry or don't satisfy, they will go out and tell 11 people what bad service they got. For every customer you satisfy, they go out and tell three people. So Tim, just to break even, we got to satisfy four times as many as we make unhappy. So work hard at making people happy. You and I as Christians need to understand it is the belief that drives our attitude, that directs our activity, and we need an attitude of thankfulness because of the love of God. Number two, the other observation, David reminds us of the benefits of the Lord's presence. Notice in verses 5 and 6, he said, I will not be afraid. I will not be afraid, and I will have victory over my enemies. When we understand the benefits that God is in us, when we become a Christian, when our sin has been forgiven and we open our hearts to Him, God and the person of the Holy Spirit comes to live within our human spirit, and He brings to us all that God is for everything that we need. That's what it means to be a Christian. It is not signing a paper that says, I agree with what this church believes. It is believing that I am made in the image of God, and that image is not the fact that I have two hands and two feet and a large nose and two eyes. But what makes me in the image of God is my human spirit. God is spirit, and those who worship Him in spirit and in truth. And what enables me to reflect His image through my life is when His Spirit is in residence within my human spirit, so that the fruit of the Spirit becomes evident in a growing, maturing way in your life and mine. When we know that He is with us, then we have courage to face the difficult moments of life, and we know that ultimately we win. We may lose some battles, but we do not lose the war. We win. Number three. The third observation, David encourages us to trust the Lord over humanity and government. Notice what he says in verse 8 and 9. It's better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. Don't put your confidence in me as a pastor. I will let you down. I will fail. Don't put your confidence in your spouse or in your kids, in your employer. We will all fail at some time or another, and some of us will fail more frequently than others. That is not where we take our refuge. Don't take your refuge, he says, in princes. What does that mean? In government. David's the king. He said, don't put your confidence in what we provide for you. Put your confidence in God. That's what will make a difference in our attitude and our behavior on a daily basis, because we're often going to be disappointed with each other, and we are frequently going to be mad at government. I don't care what kind of government it is. And so he says, don't take your refuge. What man and government can provide, take your refuge in God Himself. The fourth observation David makes in verses 10 through 14, David expressed the Lord's sufficiency when surrounded by his enemies. He says, all the nations surrounded me, but I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side, but in the name of the Lord I cut them off. They swarmed at me like bees, but in the name of the Lord I cut them off. What does that mean? It means David didn't always have a nice time in his life. You will not always have a nice time in your life. Sometimes it will be physical affliction. Sometimes it's going to be emotional challenges. Sometimes it's going to be betrayal. Sometimes it's going to simply be we have our own pity parties. But life is not always going to be pleasant. And so how did David deal with the enemies of his life? He said, in the name of the Lord, I cut it off. What's he saying? David's saying, I simply live as if they don't exist. In the name of God, I live as if they don't exist. They are not my problem. They are God's problem. So I'm not going to let them mess up my life. I'm not going to let them stop me from enjoying this day that God has made. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. That's God's business to deal with. I don't have to take care of them. Just cut them off. But do it in the name of the Lord. Remember, belief dictates attitude, which drives behavior. If we don't do it in the name of the Lord, we might do it in the wrong spirit. All right? Next. David appreciated the Lord's discipline and grace in verses 17 and 18. I will not die, but I will live. The Lord has chastened me severely, but He's not given me over to death. I think David is probably remembering his Bathsheba moment. David is remembering when he stepped out of the will of God. He stepped out of what he believed. He allowed circumstances, being on a rooftop late at night when he should have been out in field preparing for battle. He allowed his circumstances to dictate his attitude and determine his behavior. And David was estranged at the time. But God still loved David. And God sent a prophet to talk to David about the issue. And David came to his senses and he came to a place of repentance. We looked at that passage earlier a few weeks ago where David said, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." And he says, "Okay, the Lord has disciplined me, but he's not given me over to death. There is still a purpose that God wants to fulfill in my life, and until that time comes, I will live to tell of God." David's time had not yet come. Falls in line with what we talked about last week, that our life as believers on this earth is immortal until our work is done. When God's finished with us, he'll call us home. Do not think you can go out and do stupid things. Okay? This is not being presumptuous. This is being faithful. I can trust God for when my moment to leave this world is supposed to happen. Next, verses 19 through 21, David knows he should never stray from a spirit of thankfulness. David starts out with gratitude. In the middle of this chapter, he comes back to gratitude. At the end of this song, he comes back to gratitude again. So that tells me this is the key. There needs to be less grumbling and more gratitude in our lives. After the enemies, after the government, after his discipline, he doesn't want to forget gratitude. In spite of all these other circumstantial challenges, don't forget to be grateful for what? For the love of God. Never stray from that. That's found in verses 19 through 21. Next, I think it's number 7. David remembers where he came from, and he appreciates the Lord's grace. The stone the builders rejected has become the capstone. There's a passage in the New Testament where Paul writes that Jesus Christ is the chief cornerstone of the church. He was rejected by the builders, rejected by the Pharisees and the Sadducees, rejected by the people of Israel, yet God chose him to be the cornerstone. And there are some who would say this is a prophetic psalm talking about Jesus. I'm going to suggest something slightly different to you today. This is Paul, who would have known this psalm well because of Paul's education. Paul would have known this psalm very well. Remember, this is the last of those that we've looked at. You know, there's a group of psalms that are sung at every key Israel feast and special day and holy day, and it's Psalm 113 through Psalm 118. Paul, with his education and his training, would have known this psalm. And I suggest to you that what we have in the New Testament that makes the Old Testament look prophetic is Paul knowing his Old Testament well and making an application to Jesus Christ. Because David was David Samuel's first choice to become the next king of Israel? Remember, the oldest brother stepped in the room first, and Samuel said, "Put him in the chair, let's anoint him." And God whispered to him, "No, no, it's not the one." And then they brought in the next brother. "No, not the one, the next one." I think if my math is correct, David was number 11. Okay? He was at the bottom of the list. He only had one baby brother younger than him. And so David said, "Hey, the stone builders rejected me. I was not their first choice, but the Lord had plans for me. The world may say no, but when God says yes, the world can't stop it." David said, "That's my life." And that then brought him to this key verse, which, again, most of us may have not known the address, but we know this verse. "This is the day that the Lord has, I will rejoice and I will be glad in it." Yeah. David appreciates the Lord's grace In spite of the fact that he was small and young, God still chose him. David in this passage does a couple of things in this verse. One, he emphasizes the value of time. You may look around this room and you could find some people who have more money than you. You could look around this room and you could find people who have more stuff than you. You could find people, if you looked around the room, and you could find people who might have better looks than you. Just look up here. kidding. Here's the deal. There is something all of us in this room share and share alike. None of us have more. We all woke up this morning with the same amount of time today. And that's the thrust of what David was saying here, that what he believed dictated his attitude. He says, this is the day. He's not talking about his yesterdays when he had failures and victories. He's not talking about his tomorrows, which are still uncertain. He's talking about today. And David, first of all, says to us, we must appreciate this day as a gift from God. He's given it to you. Bill Hybels in the leadership conference this week said, I wish I could have told you I learned this a long time ago, but it's only been in recent years that I've learned to do this. He said, when I wake up in the morning, I don't stand up anymore. He said, I roll out of bed to my knees. If I stand up, I have the idea maybe that I'm going to get through this day. He said, when I hit my knees, I'm letting God know at the very outset, this is the day that He has made. And I want Him to do whatever He wants to do in me throughout this day. Appreciate it as a gift from God. Number two, we need to dedicate each day to the glory of God. God, what do you want to do in my life, in the hours that you give to me today? And then let's celebrate this day in the goodness of God. Let's live life as it is a celebration. How many folks know that you're celebrating life today? Oh, can't wait to join that party. Yeah. This is the day the Lord has made. Yesterday is gone. Tomorrow's not here. We all have the same amount today. Folks, let me take this analogy just a little further. This is the life the Lord has given. Where you are right now, in spite of the past, in spite of your plans for the future, where you are today, this is what the Lord has given for your life. What are we going to do with it? This is the family that the Lord has provided, whether it's physical or spiritual family. This is it. I've had some folks say, Tim, I'm the last one of my family. Hey, if you're the last, man, go down well. Hey, what does God want to still do in your life in the days that He still has to give to you? The family that you're with, how are you going to care for them? This church family, I don't know where you've come from sometimes in the past that ended up here. This is your church family. How are you going to choose this context of this family? How are you, Tim, I'm part of a small group. Boy, other small groups sound a whole lot more fun than mine. What could you do about that? Oh, change groups! What happens when you change group three times and all of them are no fun? See, maybe the issue is not the group. Maybe the issue is I do not have a belief that directs my attitude, which drives my behavior. And that's the belief that this is the day God has made, and you don't appreciate that gift, and you don't dedicate it, and you don't celebrate it. And then this is the work the Lord has directed. This is the work that you were in. Tim, I got a lousy job. You're there. What are you doing with it? Do it all to the glory of God. When we flourish in our faith, our family, our life, and our work have a purpose and a power that provides stability when trouble attacks our life, our family, and our work. But when we choose to flourish in our life, our family, or our work and ignore our faith, trouble in any one or all of those other areas will often bring devastation to us. This is the attitude in which I will live my life, David says. I will rejoice to God for who He is, and I will be glad for what He has provided. The choice to rejoice impacts attitude. David wraps this up with a prayer. In that prayer, in those last few verses, he declares his dependence upon God for saving him and success in his life. He proclaims God's favor as the source of light, and he offers his life as a living sacrifice. And he personalizes his commitment. And this is the key, folks. Have you personalized a commitment to God? David said, "You are my God." This is the same writer who said, "The Lord is my shepherd." When He's mine, we give thanks to Him. Let me close with a story. This is a Paul Harvey rest of the story. It is gratitude that prompted an old man to visit an old broken pier on the eastern seacoast of Florida. Every Friday night until his death in 1973, he would return walking slowly and slightly stooped with a large bucket of shrimp. The seagulls would flock to this old man and he would feed them from the bucket. Many years before, in October 1942, Captain Eddie Rickenbacker was on a mission on a B-17 to deliver an important message to General MacArthur in New Guinea. But there was an unexpected detour which would hurl Captain Eddie into the most harrowing adventure of his life. Somewhere over the South Pacific, the Flying Fortress became lost beyond the reach of radio contact. Fuel ran low and the men ditched their plane in the ocean. For nearly a month, 28 days to be exact, Captain Eddie and his companions would fight the water, the weather, and the scorching sun. They spent many sleepless nights recoiling as giant sharks rammed their rafts. Their largest raft was 9 feet by 5 feet. The biggest shark was 10 feet. But all their enemies at sea, one proved the most formidable: starvation. 8 days out, their rations were gone and destroyed by the salt water. It would take a miracle to sustain them. And a miracle occurred. In Captain Eddie's own words, Cherry, that was the B-17 pilot, Captain William Cherry, read the service that afternoon from the scriptures, and we finished with a prayer of deliverance and a hymn of praise. I love that. They're in a raft in the middle of the ocean, and they sing a hymn of praise. I love that. There was some talk, but it tapered off in the oppressive heat. With my hat pulled down over my eyes to keep out some of the glare, I dozed off. Now, this is still Captain Rickenbacker talking, and he said, "Something landed on my head. I instinctively knew it was a seagull. I don't know how I knew, I just knew, and everybody else knew too. No one said a word, but peering out from under my hat brim without moving my head, I could see the expression on every one of their faces. They were staring at the gull. The gull meant food, if I could catch it. And the rest, as they say, is history. Captain Eddie caught the gull. Its flesh was eaten. Its intestines were used as bait to catch more fish. The survivors were stained and their hopes renewed because of one lone seagull, uncharacteristically hundreds of miles from land, offered itself as a sacrifice. You know what Captain Eddie made of it? And now you also know that he never forgot, because every Friday evening about sunset on a lonely stretch along the eastern Florida seacoast, you could see an old man walking, white-haired, bushy-eyed, slightly bent, his bucket filled with shrimp to feed the gulls. To remember that one, on a day long past, gave himself without a struggle, like manna in the wilderness. And folks, 2,000 years ago, one came from an uncharacteristic long way off, and he came to live with us. And without a fight, he went to the cross to do for us what we ourselves. And David says, don't ever forget to be grateful for the love of God. Let's pray. Father, there's so much in this world that causes us to become cynical. It causes us or prompts us to behave unkindly. And I think it's because we have more anger than we do love. We have more criticism than we do compliments. And so, Father, I pray that we will let what we believe, and maybe the problem is we don't know enough about who we believe in, And if we don't, may we learn so that the belief in your truth will drive our attitudes so that our actions will be directed by our love for you. If there's anyone in this room, Father, that has never been able to say, Lord, you are my God, I pray using their own words in the quietness of this moment, they'll say, Lord, I want you today to be my God. For this is the day that you have made. You brought me here for a purpose, and I'm ready for that purpose to be carried out. Come live within my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen and amen. Guys, have a great afternoon. See you next week or Tuesday night.